Thank God for the daylight. I spent a long time in the dark. Felt good saying goodbye. Waking up to a brand new heart. And if you're sleeping like I used to be, in a grave that holds you tight, there's a savior calling. Promising a brand new life. He's saying, wake up. I bet you like that freedom. Ooh, I bet you like your new name. Oh, welcome to the kingdom. Yeah, we all feel that way. So if you see somebody sleeping like the way you used to be, tell them about the Savior. Then, and a little thing called free. Go ahead and say, wake up. Amazing grace, all sleeper, won't you come awake, come awake. Rise up and come out of that grave. Rise up in that amazing grace, all sleeper, won't you come awake, come awake.
Before we get into our opening of welcome and announcements, I would like to offer a special prayer at this one-year mark of pandemic. Would you please bow your heads and pray with me? Loving Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we join now in prayer before you today. We pray to you reflecting upon a painful milestone. It has been a year since the lethal sting of a viral infection became a global nightmare for humankind, a pandemic. It has been a year, and we are here before you today. This past year taught us to minimize, to improvise, to compromise, to adapt to different behavior. During this year, we slowed down, we paused, we realized what we had to do without, and we cried. We mourned for those who died. There have been so many, and we mourned for them. And we mourned for the losses of job, we mourned for social injustice, and for our country so politically divided. We worried about ourselves. We worried about the aged, alone and isolated and vulnerable. We worried about the young, the children. Could their minds handle all that was being thrown at them in this pandemic? But then, as disciples of Christ, we turn to you and we work together as a church family to collect ourselves. We steeled up, we adjusted, we empathized, we prayed harder, we sympathized, and we stepped up We stepped in where we were needed. We reached out. We called, we telephoned. We cooked. We fed and fed some more. And we loved as you taught us to love. And now, O Lord, we look ahead. It is 2021. It will be another challenging year, but it will be a different year. And there are now vaccines to protect our physical health that continue to arrive and be available. The bleak, dark midwinter is behind us, hopefully. Your light of peace and grace and hope shines so brightly as our eyes are opening wider to see it. We give thanks and praise you for your steadfast grace and mercy. As we continue to move forward during this challenging time and leave that year behind us, O Lord, we pray this prayer. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all we ask of you. Lord, help me today. Show me the way. I know you will see me through. In your name we pray. Amen. Anna, good morning. Welcome to our worship service for this day, this fourth Sunday in Lent, March 14th, 2021. It is great to be with you, and it is a time for sharing of some information about our church, some announcements. I first would ask your prayers, blessings, and it's a joy to have her as part of our worship today, as it always is. But my dear sister in Christ and clergy colleague, Pastor Kathy, is joining us from Putnam Hospital, where she's being treated for pneumonia. And hopefully Pastor Kathy will be bouncing back and be amongst us and be in ministry, as I know she always is. So we keep you in our prayers constantly, Kathy, and we ask you to do what the doctors say and be a good patient. So some announcements. This is the latest vaccine advisory. Once again, we have put the website for enrollment in the Dutchess County database for appointments in Dutchess County sites. Anyone can enroll in this site, and the phone number, the Dutchess County government phone number, is also listed. And there, even though they've had some bumps with that and some difficulty administratively, I believe it's working again. And if you call that number, the 486-3555, and select option 2, you should be able to talk to someone to enroll for for vaccine. And you also may enroll others. If you're helping someone who either can't use the phone or someone who's disabled, they will allow you to enroll them as well. So that phone number is available to you, and it should be working properly. I sat in on a seminar with the Dutchess County Executive Mark Molinaro this week, and his Department of Health doctor and a number of other clergy people, and they are working hard to be available and supportive as we are now in the season of vaccination. So option one on this phone call, on this phone number, as you can see also, is a recitation of a list of sites. So please, if you or anyone you know needs help and support in getting in line for vaccination, use these resources, and you may also call me or your local church for support. And Pastor Kathy and I thank all of you who have been in ministry with us this year. Thank you, thank you, and thank you. This is Umcor Sunday. This is a special point in the calendar each year where the United Methodist Committee on Relief, which provides disaster response all around the world, asks for special support. Umcor donations at 100% on the dollar go directly to help human beings in need. So please keep this in mind. I know some of you have already sent into your churches special contributions for specific disaster scenes and situations. I thank you for that. And if you can, in your generosity, send a special contribution earmarked for UMCOR, UMCOR, for disaster relief around the world from the United Methodist Church. In 2 weeks, the parish council and the pastors in a recent meeting have decided that we will open the sanctuaries in Pauling and Pokweg and begin to worship again, just like we did for a while last fall before the virus spiked up again. We will have a live worship service at Pokweg at 9 a.m. and a live and Zoom service from Pauling at 11 a.m. And the protocols for health protection, spacing, masks, and the pre and post cleaning work by our teams will be in effect just like they were last September and October. So we're pleased that we're taking a step forward, and we will continue to Zoom at this time each week. So those of you who cannot or choose not to recongregate quite yet, we'll look for you here on Zoom at 11 o'clock every Sunday. The churches of Pokweg and Verbank are planning an Easter sunrise service outdoors at their sites in those towns respectively. And more details and specific times will be provided in the next week or so as we get closer to Easter. And we look forward to being there and greeting you on what I hope is a gorgeous, beautiful Easter Sunday morning. The parish has established an outreach ministry. They launched it about a week ago for residents of the Grand in Pauling, which is a rehab residence where our own Jerry Meyer is now residing. And they are still under a modified lockdown. No visitors are allowed quite yet to their premises. And so with Jerry's initiative, we have started a greeting card ministry, and you're asked to join as you will and write a positive greeting for someone who is in at the Grand, and on the outside of the envelope indicate whether it's for a woman or a man or a veteran or anyone in particular. And there are detailed instructions for how you can get them to us in the announcements section of the email invitation to this service. Essentially, if you're in the food delivery ministry on Wednesday, you can give it to your driver deliverer, or you can forward bring them to the Pauling Church on Wednesday afternoons. And deliver them to the team, the help ministry team in the kitchen, or send them to the Pauling Church and we'll compile them and deliver them for you. So thank you in advance for joining our card outreach ministry for the folks who are disabled at the Grand. And And Grace continues to work with the Pauling Resource Center in their outreach and missions. And we're collecting Easter candy, as you can see on your screen. Are there any other announcements? Okay, I don't see any hands, so let us continue with our worship service for the fourth Sunday in Lent.
We continue our Lenten season of recovery as we focus on health as essential to our spiritual lives. Prolonged times of difficulty can impede our ability to stay creative. The picture of our lives is dulled, and hope for a brighter future can fade.
Souls holy and whole, broken, needing the one, open body and soul, healer come. We
need a touch of inspiration to awaken us from our sleep. As we hear in one of this week's healing stories, we also awaken to our agency to seek out the divine healer, reaching out to touch the power we know can restore our intellect and imagination. We emerge ready to re-engage with the world, seeking and seeing solutions, creating different pictures of life renewed, just as a mosaic artist creates beauty from broken pieces of glass.
Vessels holy and whole, broken, needing the one, open body and soul, healer come.
As we feel the healer coming to join us today, I ask you to take a deep breath. Let it in and let it out. And feel the healing spirit of God that we know is always with us. And as we think about where we are today, let's take that feeling of warmth and wellness and extend it to others, extend it to those that are close to you in your household, those that you interact with regularly at home or at work or at school, in your neighborhood or in your community, and certainly within your church family. Let that feeling of wellness and well-being spread and share that with a smile with those that you meet this week. Let it expand to the world so that all that meet you know that you are a disciple of Christ and his grace and mercy radiates from you as well. Now I ask you to reach out in our worship service and extend the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ with one another. May the peace of the Lord be with you all.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace of Christ, all my brothers and sisters.
Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading today once again comes from the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 9, as we hear the actions of and teachings of Jesus after he delivered the Sermon on the Mount. From chapter 9, beginning at verse 18. Now, while he was saying these things to them, suddenly a leader of the synagogue came and knelt before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her and she will live." So Jesus got up and followed him with his disciples. And while they were walking, suddenly a woman who had been suffering long from hemorrhaging for over 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. For she had said to herself, "If I can only touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned and, seeing her, said to her, "Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well." And instantly the woman was made well. When Jesus continued and came to the leader's house, he saw the flute players and the crowd making a commotion. And he told them, "Go away, for this girl is not dead, but only sleeping." The crowd laughed at him. But after they had been moved outside, Jesus went in, took the girl by the hand, and the girl got up. And the report of this spread throughout all that region. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Our Lenten series, Holy Vessels, continues this week with more stories from Matthew's gospel that are focused in on the healing and restoration to health that Jesus brought after his famous Sermon on the Mount was given. Healing and restoration, very appropriate topics at this 1 year anniversary mark of the COVID pandemic. Our gospel lesson today adds an additional dimension of waking up, or waking the dead, in this case, the almost dead, that young girl. Awake. Awake and do. That is our message for today. Now, these stories from Matthew 8 and 9 are a group of healing stories that we've studied the last several weeks. And the previous two, if you remember them, involved the healing of a blind man and then the healing of another man who was both mute and possessed by a demon. Now, all this is happening in fulfillment to a prophetic voice in the Bible, a verse rather in the Bible that said, "Then Jesus went about all the cities and the villages, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and every sickness among the people." Now we hear this story today, this story of two female persons, a woman with a hemorrhage. And that story is set inside the story of a little girl who had died, evidently. Now, the other gospel writers, Mark and Luke, tell the story in significantly greater detail. One of them, I believe Mark, actually tells us the name of the little girl's father, whose name is Jairus, who is one of the rabbis in the synagogue. And in the Mark and Luke tellings of the story we heard today, the daughter is at the point of death. She's not quite dead yet. But when Matthew tells it, she is dead. Now, the stories of these two women, they have some interesting parallels, which is why I think the Bible presents them wrapped within each other. Now, both the people in this story are called daughter. Okay, both are restored. Both come one personally and one with the dad who's calling for Jesus' help. The woman has been ill for 12 years, and the little girl is 12 years old. Both the woman and the little girl have been cut off from normal society because of their physical condition. The Jewish law prohibited touching a woman who was bleeding. And the law also had strict prohibitions about touching a corpse or a dead person. Now, in both these cases, Jesus ignored that Jewish law that he had read and taught and interpreted since he was a young person. And he continues to heal despite this prohibition about touching either of these two people. And both of these stories involve females. We know that way back in the Middle Ages in those days, women did not have a high place in society. And in some locations, they had very few rights, in fact. And the fact that the father of the little girl throws himself at Jesus' feet for the sake of his daughter, who he loves so dearly, really says something positive about him, especially as a church official, because of the customs of the day. Now, there are also differences between the stories of these two people. The father of the girl is a man of high standing in the community. He's an official of the temple. And the woman is unclean, an outcast. The man approaches Jesus very boldly, but the woman approaches him timidly and tries to touch the tip of his coat. Now, the woman herself had been an outcast for 12 years. And even though she did approach Jesus timidly, she was desperate for help. And she had the courage, the guts to reach out to someone she thought could help her. After 12 years of living separately, it would be extremely different, I would think, to approach another person. The taboo associated with touching or being touched by others would be overwhelming. But that woman did it. She did it in an act of brave desperation. She's determined to touch Jesus' clothing in the hope that even a small contact with this teacher, this savior, this miracle man might restore her health. Jesus sees her and regards her. And we have to wonder how long it has been since someone had actually looked at this woman and looked her in the eye. People were accustomed in that town to avoid her, to walk away from, pass on the other side of the street. They didn't want to be contaminated by someone who was unclean. But Jesus says, "Daughter, cheer up." He calls her daughter. "Your faith has made you well. Your faith has made you well." Jesus is not bragging about himself here. He's not trumpeting his own action, but he credits the woman for her faith. And he publicly acknowledges that her healing will make a difference in her life. It's really a huge first step into her returning to normal society. She's awakened. She's awakened from a kind of sleep and awful, long-standing isolation. And she now has an opportunity for a life of her own. What a joy it must have been for her. Now, as we go back to the story of the little girl and the father, when Jesus got to the house where the little girl was, the funeral of the little girl had already begun. We heard in the gospel text that flute players were playing and people were making a commotion. Now, the custom way back when was that in Jewish life, for a funeral, even poor people would have at least two flutes and one mourning or wailing singer. That was the requirement for a funeral. An interesting fact for us here. But Jesus comes in and says, make room. This girl isn't dead, but only sleeping. And the crowd immediately laughs at him. They know the girl's dead, or at least they think they know. And they think that this Jesus is going to be making a fool of himself. So Jesus doesn't invite the crowd up to where the girl is lying. He basically has them leave. And one of the reasons he did that is he wanted a quiet and calm place for this little young girl of age 12 to wake up again. And so Jesus went in and took her by the hand. And once again, he was seen as someone touching a dead body. He renders himself in the eyes of others being ritually unclean. But he didn't care. He touched that woman. And the girl arose. She was awakened. In fact, the word in the ancient text for this story is resurrection. She was resurrected. Now, this story is very reminiscent of the restoration of life story that is in the Old Testament. The prophet Elijah restored the life of a child, and also his disciple Elisha did the same. And we can be sure that this crowd that we heard about in Matthew was very well familiar with those stories from the old Jewish Bible. And they would make the connection between the Elijah and Elisha stories and what they had just witnessed with this Rabbi Jesus Christ. They would understand that just like Elijah and Elisha, Jesus acted by the power of God. And the story concludes, and a report went out into all the land. The word of such a healing act, a resurrection, would spread like wildfire in the area in that day. And it did. This story in the gospel today, I think, has some parallels for us, especially the awaking of the little girl. So many of us have been sleeping in various ways since the onset of this pandemic. Now, we haven't gone to sleep willfully or on purpose, but we've been locked down. We've been locked in, quarantined. We've been shut out of the places that we usually go, threatened by illness, confronted by death, and being confused by it all in a state of stress that it just frankly felt awful that year that was. We've been induced into a more limited lifestyle, which sometimes feels like sleepwalking. And oh, like those in the story today, do we really need Jesus to wake us and help us regain our bright, lively, joyful lives and our bushy-tailed selves that are still inside us? Jesus indeed is always ready to heal and inspire us through these times of stress and depression. And that's up to us to follow his healing light and to take steps to reinvigorate our daily lives. And I think the onset of spring and the daylight savings that we're in now is a great time to make a special effort to do that, to follow his healing light. I know I personally am feeling more energized and intellectually awake in the last few weeks, especially after I got my first shot. I really felt a lot better. This great gift of effective medication is spreading around the world now, and the progress, I think, has brightened prospects for a freer and hopefully more enjoyable summer and fall that we have coming to us. We now have a growing confidence to carefully regather in our sanctuaries in the next couple of weeks. And I praise God for all of this light that I perceive is coming to us now. Through his healing miracles, Jesus Christ shows us the way out of this paralysis or sleepwalking, this isolation and inactivity, to a state where once again we can feel awake and experience more joy each and every day. I say, let's follow him and continue to awaken ourselves as we serve him and we serve our neighbors in his name in the days ahead. Are you with me? Amen.
I rest my weary
And amen. Now is the time, brothers and sisters, for us to share our joys, our concerns, our prayers for ourselves, our families, our church family, and those that we know in our lives. And I ask that you raise your hand if you have something to share or you would like to lift someone in prayer today. And I would begin by, again, thanking God for the ministry of Pastor Kathy Meyerson and wish her healing of the Lord and safe return to us in our ministry here in Southeast Dutchess. So, Pastor Kathy, please get well. Lord, hear my prayer. Lorenzo, please unmute.
Okay.
Hi, good morning. I just want to say thank you for all the prayers for my daughter that she was in the hospital. Unfortunately, she lost the baby. Oh, but I want to give thanks to God. And to everybody that prayed for my daughter. Lord, hear my prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers. Let us pray for the Loyola family.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vilma.
Carmen.
Yes. My joy is I got my COVID shot. It was only one shot Thursday, and I'm so happy. I thank my family for making this happen for me. And continue prayers for my continued chronic pain. Lord, hear my prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Yes.
If I may, just prayers for Jocelyn as she's still going through the legacy of the paralysis in relation to some sort of tick-borne disease. And as we go through our next phase of physical rehab and specialists and other things like that, so that she can have kind of a normal life, if you will. Hear my prayer.
Prayers for Jocelyn and Edlin. Yeah,
Priscilla can't make it this morning. She asked for travel prayers for her daughter, Jenny, and her son-in-law, John, and the three dogs who will be leaving for New World in Kansas City tomorrow morning. They're starting a new phase of their life out there. And also, a happy birthday in heaven for this Tuesday for our lovely Diana Greco.
Yeah.
66. Say we miss dearly. Yeah. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers. Jack? Go ahead.
Can you prayers for my cousin's wife, Carmen, as she, 1 year anniversary of her dealing with this terrible disease. Let us pray that God is merciful. Lord, hear my prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our Amen. Prayer.
Amen.
I see Sheila waving her hand.
Okay. Sheila?
A prayer of thanks for Jerry's healing. He's come a long way. He's going to start outpatient therapy. Nursing services have been discontinued. And prayers that his healing continues. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers. Ruth Strid.
Prayers for the Fredericks family who lost their husband, grandfather, whatever, and for all those who have the virus and those who don't, may they not get it. And I got my vaccine on Tuesday in Pawling, so thank God for that. Lord, hear my prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Dorothy? Go ahead, Dorothy Knapp.
Oh, yes. I'm thankful that I decided I was using my rollator too much. So I've been trying to just plain walk more. And it's helping, and I'm thankful for that. Then I feel burdened. I'm trying to put together this little poem booklet, birthday poem to share. And then I'm to be able to influence my grandchildren in their right way. Pray that the Lord will help me to find ways to do that. Lord, hear my prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
I'd like to ask for prayers for Ruth Hogan, who is suffering with a lot of back pain.
Prayers for Ruth.
And also for Joe.
Missy Al.
Yeah, prayers for my daughter-in-law's father. He's going in surgery on this week for colon cancer. We hope everything's okay. Lord, hear our prayer.
What's his name, Al?
Mike Campbell.
Okay, prayers for Mike Campbell. Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer. Thank you.
Tom?
Prayers for my brother-in-law, Tom, in Connecticut, who's undergoing treatment for pancreatic cancer. Supposed to have an operation in April, I hear. Prayers for Tom.
Prayers for Tom. Lord, hear our prayers. Anyone on the phone have any prayers to offer? Isabel? Tricia? Michael? Allison?
Pound six.
Pound six to unmute.
Hello? Hello?
Yes, Michael.
I would like to thank Isabel Morton for a card she sent me from when my aunt passed away, and also from Mrs. Yeager. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. Lord, hear our prayer.
Thank you.
And I'd like to add to that, we Keith and I have received a lot of get well cards and support cards this week as well. And just very appreciated. Thank you for that.
Yep. Anyone else? Let us take our joys and concerns and the prayers that we have lifted and those that are still in our hearts and mind as we pray to the Lord. Let us pray. O God of power and mercy, healer of our every ill, we come before you to lift our brothers and sisters and ourselves before you and ask you to hear our cries for the healing of our body, mind, and spirit. And we know that you are always working among us and will show us the way to recovery from illnesses, grief, and pain. In all you do, you remind us that we don't have to shoulder everything by ourselves, and we give you thanks that helping us to orient ourselves toward your spirit, to accompany us, to touch us, to inspire and heal us, we too can become healed and feel the joy of your mercy and grace. We pray for those that are disabled, those who lack opportunity, those that are in danger, those that are peacekeepers, those that are givers of health and hope. We pray for those who are brave in dealing with their daily jobs. And we also pray for those that suffer from pain and depression. And we give thanks for our churches, our communities, our leaders, our medical frontline professionals, and all those that bring increased health to us in these challenging times. We ask for courage, we ask for strength, we ask for an awakening spirit of well-being in all that we do. And we thank you for your help in doing those things as Jesus would have us do. And this day, we lift the prayer that he taught us to pray so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In our threshold message and our message of this week through the scripture of Matthew, we highlighting the message that Jesus said, the girl is not dead. She is only sleeping. And we have asked in prayer for Jesus to help us lift our own spiritual lives, our own well-being, our intellect, and to step forward and see the light of his countenance and his teaching in all that we do. This is a week where we can take a different look at what's in front of us, of what we do, where we are. It's a different picture. It can be a new picture of hope, a new picture of blessing. Those of you who are using your Lenten packages can rearrange and put in a different place your beach glass and the stones and other aspects of your devotional materials. And remember that you can draw on all of the blessings and talents and gifts that God has given you as you look in a different way, in a different picture, to be awake and alive in the days ahead. Love one another and follow the teachings of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, our triune God, in all that you do. Amen. Now let us go with confidence that we too will awaken and we will seek and reach out for helping solutions for our own lives, our own work, our own doings, and reach healing solutions that will benefit our neighbors and communities that are needed right now. Extend a helping hand, continue to be in mission and ministry in all that we do. Remember that we are not dead, only sleeping, and it is now time for us to awake and allow the Holy Spirit to hover and move and deliver us forward and to heal our wounds and send us forward with a spring in our step in everything we do. And we ask this in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us awake and unmute and greet your brothers and sisters in Christ.
We're 3 weeks away from Easter. Easter is the sign of the greatest hope, and that's why they call us Easter people. God bless you all.
God bless you too.
Amen.
God bless all.
Yes.
Yes. So looking forward to seeing everybody in person on Palm Sunday.
Amen.
Yep. How'd you like those guitar chords, Tom Higgins?
I was very tired the next day. I slept all day, but I got a weird feeling after the shot, but then it was okay.
Okay, so I'm glad you're doing well.
Thank you. How about
you? We got
you?
Ours on Thursday also.
Yeah, I remember. You know what
I'm saying? Dave, thank you and Sandy for your card.
You're quite welcome. Glad Jerry's doing well.
Where's Dory going?
Hi, everyone. Have a good weekend, everyone.
Yeah, you too. You too.
Trish.
Hi.
Great day.
Good seeing everybody.
Dory.
Hi, Donna. Hi, Donna.
Hi, Mama.
Everybody be well.
Lop-eared rap.
You too.
You too.
We missed what you said, Dory.
Sorry.
What did you say?
Okay. Hi, Dorothy. How are you?
New bunny for Taylor.
Are you driving to Taylor right now?
No, she's coming.
We just drove over to Mass to pick this little one up. Keith's driving. We'll go out after Keith's appointments on the 26th. We're just going out for a quick trip. So sad I'm going to have to take care of it for the next 2 weeks. It's awful.
We can see it's really hurting you.
Yeah. Oh, that little doggy.
You kept so well to the one dog rule.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And my husband shakes his head.
Nice. Is that bunny a brother or sister that might be coming to live with you?
Well, there was a sister, but I left her there, so.
Okay. Nice.
Is that a puppy?
No, it's a bunny.
Oh, it's a bunny.
Yeah.
Oh, how cute. Oh, my goodness. Oh. Adorable.
How appropriate.
Too cute.
Yeah.
Adorable.